thank you, everybody. Also, you should see Dan MacArthur over here. Give him a welcome. So it makes me nervous to be here alone. So because I've done thousands and thousands of shows with somebody else standing right beside me. So that's what I'm doing. That's my goddamn.
We'll start, okay?
I can't juggle.
No. We'll start. So okay. I'll start with my book. Also, by the way, this is your opportunity tonight. I hope that you brought a checkbook with you, because for the first time ever in history, the complete collected works of Peter Gould are going to be auctioned off. And it's even more, there's more at stake, because the auctioneer is going to be the person who wrote the book, too. So the collected works of Peter Gould, there are six books here. I mean, I moved to the farm in 1969, October 1st, 1969, and in 3 weeks from that date, my father died. He died suddenly. And I used the fact of my father's death and the fact that I had just moved to this beautiful place in Vermont, and also the fact that I had scribbled for 2 or 3 years notes for a first novel, to actually give myself a real kick in the butt and write my first novel. And that first novel was called Burnt Toast. How many people have read Burnt Toast? Cool. And how many people own a copy of Burnt Toast? If I were you, I would hold on to that copy, because every year I buy one or two copies, because I meet somebody, one of my students, who I think that they should really read this book, and I go online and I order a copy. Usually costs me about $7 and $3 or $4 shipping. So knowing that I was going to give one up tonight, I only have 4 or 5. I went online to see what was out there. And there are only 3 copies left on Amazon used book service. And the cheapest one is $100. Wow. And the middle one is $1,500. And the most expensive one is $2,000. So if you happen to have one, hold on to it, okay? Because I don't know why. And there are other places that you can buy used books too. But I mean, if you happen to have it, you were going to say, Deborah?
I checked it out today.
Yeah?
And the two that are at $103 are being sold by a bookseller in Brattleboro. It's a 254 number.
I have to find out who that is. You know, I'm going to kneecap him. But anyway, I'll read a little bit. Actually, and one of the, because I wanted the book that I've just written, which is called A Horse-Drawn Yogurt, that's number 6, and there's 4 books in between. I wanted that refer back to Burnt Toast. So one of the chapters from Burnt Toast is in this book, Horse-Drawn Yogurt. And that's the only chapter which is fiction. And I call it fiction just because it hasn't happened yet.
So I'll
read. I'm going to read from the epigraph. One of the things in this book which I didn't write. It's by Walter Benjamin, who was a famous famous German Jewish historian. And people here in Putney should know about Walter Benjamin, because Sandglass Theater has created a whole puppet show about him. To articulate the past historically does not mean to recognize it the way it really was. It means to seize hold of a memory as it flashes up at a moment of danger. That's the epigraph that I chose to put in this book, because I've been working on the book for years, and suddenly I felt, no, there's a reason to put the book out, because we're living through a moment, a real danger. And if you read the whole page from which the book, this quote is from, you'll see that he's speaking about the fact that in each age, people who believe and think in a certain way, and who've carried the memory with them of times, not necessarily of a golden age, but when people were honest and true, and when they had a dedication to truth, they have to fight harder than they ever had to. And it seems like it happens over and over again, because they get subjected to a confrontation with a conformity that's going to be so powerful and so and denying of truth that even the dead will not be safe. That's what he says. And so it became that I wanted to write this book because the memory of the years in which I and a whole generation of people moved to Vermont and to so many other places, that memory is strong, and it's of a quality time. And it's not just that I want to live in the past. I just want to make sure that there's the young people today, particularly the young people who every time I tell some of these stories from the farm, they get this look on their face like, oh my God, I wish I could do that. I wish I could live that way too. So that's why I wrote the book. And I felt like I had to explain that in a little bit more depth. So in this story about how I came to the farm, I'm writing about the trip I took. Because I had been off in search of myself out west. I was kind of a yo-yo, east and west, west and east. Until I really realized that it was to Packer Corners Farm in Vermont that I wanted to go. I'm driving east in my old Volvo 122 deep into the night, hundreds of miles into Montana. Just me, no passenger. It's September 1969. My car is a tiny, beaming island speeding through the pure dark of the big sky country. I don't know what time it is. No car radio, no watch, no clock. I can't even see how fast I'm going or how far I've come because I don't want to know. Before I started, I put duct tape over every instrument on the panel. Suddenly, a big jackrabbit darts in front of me, freezes in my headlights. I hit the brakes hard. My lights catch the rabbit's eyes, but right before I slam into him, a huge owl dives down and rips him from the roadway. Full talon grip, beat of wings, and we all scream, all of us. Me in terror, the owl in triumph, the car in a skid, the rabbit plucked to his death. I pull off the highway on an exit with no name, and I park by a barbed wire fence. I hop out and I piss on a post, brush my teeth, get in the back seat, open all four windows a crack, lock the doors, crawl into my army surplus, goose feather, sleeping bag, and sleep. And I'm back on the road at sunup eating nuts and raisins and this new food I've just discovered called granola. I'm heading to the farm in Vermont, and if you'd look down from way above, end of the summer of 69, you'd have seen hundreds, no, thousands of us. Alone, or couples, or in a family group, driving, hitching, riding the rails over long cross-continent distances, or short hikes through unfamiliar woods, all of us heading to a particular piece, not all the same piece, of ground. Visions of Jack Kerouac and Neil Cassidy and Woody Guthrie in our heads, a Bob Dylan song on our lips. A chosen place somewhere in the land between where Guthrie's rolling Columbia River spilled into the Pacific and where the stone walls of New England marked out ancient abandoned settlements that new pioneers were suddenly about to come back to. It was a movement, but you can be in a movement and not see it. You may feel the group you're a part of come together now and again, but you still feel like you're on your own individual journey, driving through the night and day. It felt just like that to me. It was more than a movement. Think of a tide. Like the biggest, highest tide you could picture, and you were caught in it and trying to find a footing. But for months you couldn't. That's how it felt to be alive in 68, 69, 70. Whether you were willing or not, whether you thought you were participating or not, you got swept up and swept along by a rising, storming, out-of-control tide of current events, with waves getting higher and higher, and you hardly had time to breathe and hit rock-solid ground again before the next wave hit. The next wave of events, I mean. That's how it felt. Today, it feels like that again. We were looking for our footing, our grounding somewhere away from the war. Most of us hated the Vietnam War. That's what we called it. In Vietnam, it's called the American War. As horrible as it was for us, it was even more devastating for the Vietnamese. Keep that in your head, okay? Never lose that thought. And it was so hard on our soldiers who fought the war. You stand at that shiny black memorial in Washington, and you start reading off those 55,000 names, and you just can't believe it. And then you think of the hundreds of thousands who didn't die, but who came out of it wounded and scarred for the rest of their lives. And you think of the 2 million Vietnamese who may have died. So then I speak about how it felt to live through part of that year. Jumping ahead, we began to look around. and feel what some of us had never felt before in our lives. The civil rights marchers had felt it. It was solidarity, reaching out for you. It was a community that could pull you along. And after the newest, highest tide you'd ever felt had carried you, kicking, off balance, keeping your head above, the community began to feel like it could carry you to safety in a new, strange place, somewhere like Total Lost Farm. Well, I had a map the first time I came to the farm, which was in 1968. I didn't come to stay that night. I just came because I felt that I had to get out of the city. I was watching the Chicago convention where the cops were busting heads and everybody looked just like me. I thought I'd passed the map's long pond on the left, but I couldn't be sure. But there was Dot Henry's dairy farm, like it said. And then the big apple tree where you turn right and begin the 2 miles of uphill curves and straightaways. I felt like I was being led right to the doorway. I was being led. I turned off the engine. I stepped out to incredible quiet, to Vermont August night air that felt so fresh and sweet and cool. This was the first time I'd ever been in Vermont, too, coming out of Boston. In the pitch dark, I couldn't see the peeling yellow paint on the house, the tractor shed leaning to the south, the barn with outhouse attached, the gentle slope to the peach orchard and the pines, or the place halfway to the corners where Rosie Franklin had started up her car, waved to the hippies, said, "There's no key," and left her farm forever. I took a deep breath there while I waited. The farm is where I landed, where the flood tide of all that was happening around me dropped me, as they say, high and dry. But I didn't land quite yet, not for a year. It's important to know how it feels to be 20 or 25. Maybe you've forgotten, and you need to remember how that was. Or maybe you're there right now, and it's dawning on you. Or if you're younger, you need to prepare yourself. There's this thing called the zeitgeist. Different people who capture our attention try to define the times for the rest of us with their music or their art or their social commentary, and some of these ideas take hold and stick around. And if you're young and thoughtful, given to reflection, and not already on a fixed path of career and attitude, you have to consider, what is your place in the spirit of the times? Does the zeitgeist help you to clear up mysteries in yourself? Raymond Mungo, one of the founders of the farm, he used to call that striving to understand. And we did a lot of that at the farm. Everybody say that, striving to understand. Sometimes you feel yourself in a particular mood. I'm striving to understand. For the first time ever in our country's history, the zeitgeist included a utopian movement that was truly national. It was back to the land and across the land. It bloomed individually in every state. But everywhere a farm began, it exerted a gravitational pull that was both local and national. Ex-college students, graduates, city people somehow heard about a place and arrived to see what skills of theirs might be needed. High school kids jumped off the school bus and hiked up the logging roads to find out what was really going on. They didn't take their parents' word for it. Runaways arrived who had no other place to go. So that's where I was heading to. Sometimes by day, I turned my rearview mirror right to myself to see my own face and talk and sing to myself as I drove. Some days I made 600 miles. I had plenty of time to think. You put yourself out on the highway, on the Great Plains, in the dead middle of the night, and you'll start thinking too, why am I here? And here has so many meanings. You'll tuck into your army surplus goose and duck feather bag and lie there confronting feelings like loneliness and fear and regret, anger and confusion, and thinking about the things in your own life that brought you here, to this remote place you want to catch some sleep in, and nobody, no one knows you are there. So I'm always a person who's looking for signs. How many people here look for signs that their life is on the right track? This is a book about that. It's a book about the quantum experience of suddenly seeing a sign and knowing, it's been confirmed, I'm on the right track. Or something hits you that you're totally on the wrong track and it picks you up and puts you in some other place where you have to move on from, another kind of quantum experience. So right here, I did see plenty of signs. In Montana and South Dakota, there were roadside signs for the Badlands Bones Museum. They inspired a song. If there ever has been a museum of extinction, the Badlands Bones Museum is the one. It's dinosaurs and buffalo and all the vanished beasts in between. I wrote this song in my head all the day and night as I drove, and in the dim glow of my car's dome light near where Custer last stood, I put it down on paper before I slept. And I'm so glad I did, because if I hadn't written it down, it would be gone.
It's got a chorus too. I'll sing the chorus.
Okay. Well, they're gonna sing the chorus too.
Yeah, well, okay. I'm gonna help them. Okay. They're gonna help me.
And you'll notice that when I have my concertina and singing a song, I don't need my reading glasses, because it's all right there. It was 1969, I was traveling in the night and by day, and I pretty much spent the whole day writing the song. I didn't know that there was going to be a great big fad in dinosaur songs about 15 years later. Missed that one too. I never was great, and I never was green. Dinosaur birds never pecked me clean. Don't ask me why I'm so forlorn. My folks was extinct before I was born. So don't cast my footprint. Don't set my leg. I'm not a dinosaur. I'm a dinosaur egg. That's the chorus. Try it again. I'm not a dinosaur. I'm a dinosaur egg. Yeah, yeah. When my daddy knew he was bound to die, I was just a tear in his terrible eye. He was afraid this last dinosaur batch would turn into stone and never hatch. And with her final moan, Ma parted from me. Some monkeys looked on from the limb of a tree, and then she lay down and died in the marital mud, and never a human drew dinosaur blood. So don't stone my brow, don't stab my leg, I'm not a dinosaur, I'm a dinosaur. And oh, the darkness stole over my father's pea brain, like the ice in the air where there once had been rain. And though he fought with the strength of 42 men, the mighty walk once and never again. So take me to the corner, leave me there to beg. I'm not a dinosaur, I'm a dinosaur egg. Little instrumental part here. Say the concertina plays chords, but I only ever play melody. Sorry. When death flings his mantle all over the skies, you don't need a brain of a wonderful size to know that all of the works you'd begun could turn into stone along with your son. So don't point your finger, don't slap your leg. I'm not a dinosaur, I'm a dinosaur. Hey. So I'm going to jump ahead in the story. This story, as the advertising says, is not a through line. It's not a narrative. If A, then B, if B, then C. It's a patchwork quilt. And how many people here quilt or have ever worked on a quilt? Then you probably know that sometimes when you lay out all the squares and you get the borders and things like that, you realize that there's a couple squares missing. There's something that needs to be filled in. So I've been collecting these stories, these squares, for about 25 years. And just when it was time to turn the book in, I realized that there were a few more stories that I had to write, and I wrote those. But it's never meant to be the whole story from A to B, so I can jump ahead and nobody will know. we had this great friend whose name was Ralph Rhodes. Probably never heard of him. He was a farmer who was about my age at his prime when we really were knowing him very well. And he was a dairy farmer in Leiden. And he knew everything there was to know about dairy farming, about tractors. He could field strip any farm implement. He was also a gunsmith. And some of the guns that he repaired and some of the guns that he built were famous. And he was a dead-eye shot. He could look. He took me hunting one day. He said, "Pete, you got to learn that you got to learn how to get a deer. You got to feed the family," because I had a son by then, family to feed at the farm. So he and I went out to hunt. I didn't have a license, and he didn't have a license either. But we went out. We were like way off in the woods near the farm. We were sitting there in the morning. It was a November morning. It was about 3 inches of snow on the ground. And he said, "There it is, Pete. It's your shot." Because we'd practice. I was a pretty good shot, too. And I said, what do you mean it's my shot? He said, "There's a deer." I said, "Ralph, I don't even see it, you know? I'm not going to get a shot of it, something I don't even see." He said, "Peter, it's almost out of sight. You better take it." I said, "I don't even see it, Ralph." And he went, "Oh, okay." And he just lifted his gun and bam, like that. And about a mile away, I saw this doe fall over, you know? There were so many stories about Ralph, but the school bus driver in Leiden ran off with a girl when she turned 18, and the school bus driver's wife went right down to Ralph's house and said, "You got to come up to the house, and you know there's some projects there that he's never going to finish." So that was how we got our cider press. It was a big one. Is this still up? Right. Anyway, so it was a 1920 to 25 cider press. If we had it in here, it would stick up through the ceiling. It was that big. It made 25 gallons at a squeeze. In the next, there's a long story about how I brought it to the farm with Ralph's help. In the next weeks, I learned how to field strip a 1920s Mount Gilead hydraulic cider press. It was the second farm machine I ever learned how to take apart and put back together again. But now I had a whole new language to learn. Grinder shaft and Babbitt bearings, and especially O-rings. You know about O-rings, son? Those are what failed when that Challenger space shuttle blew up in 1986. The school teacher on board and all those astronauts, they died because of the same problem we were about to have with our new cider press. The O-ring couldn't take the pressure. I learned a lot about hydraulics and food servants, lubricants and power takeoffs, and leather belting and steel comb fasteners along the way. Some of the timbers had to be rebuilt. You can't have any soft wood in a press that size. All the pressure generated by one huge piston pushing up against 700 pounds of apple mash, wet burlap, and wood frames, that would rip a weak timber right off its bolts, provided you can ever figure out how to get that piston to start heading up. We chose a nice red oak log down at Harry Evans' sawmill. He cut it to our specs, and I rebuilt pretty much all the planking for the press, teased out all rusty bolts, and bought new ones down at Dunkley's machine shop. We also built a scaffolded loading dock and tied it to the press body so we could have an eye-level place to stand, store sacks of apples, and only have to climb a couple steps to cascade the apples into the hopper. Inside that hopper was a masher, chopper, mangle, grinder, whatever you chose to call it. You need those apples cut and pulped out into chunks so fine, they're already making cider before the press part starts thumping on. What did the press run on, you'll ask? I'll tell you. You're learning how to drive a tractor now, son, and this could be a real lesson for you on how to do that. Way up above that scaffold we built, there was a big wide wheel attached to a shaft that made the apple grinder turn around inside its wooden box, and the wheel turned because it held, only by trust and friction, a 24-foot-long, 8-inch-wide leather belt. Even Jack and the Beanstalk's giant couldn't have worn that belt to hold up his pants. It was so big. It was held in a circle by a bunch of metal teeth called a comb fastener, and on the other end of the circle, the belt, what's that? Yeah, I know circles don't have ends, but if your circle is loose and you stretch it out almost flat, it kind of does. On the other end was the big wide pulley coming out of our tractor, a 1950s English Ford Super Dexter diesel. You had to park that tractor just right, just so nice, that when you ease it an inch or two forward and the belt tightened, The apple grinding wheel 12 feet up and away, the belt would stay on both wheels when you started the engine real slow, because if the angle wasn't correct, the belt would fly off and the grinder would stop and the tractor would settle into a low spot on the uneven ground because you couldn't use the emergency brake, see? The belt was the emergency brake. It was supposed to hold the tractor in place. Can you imagine how tough a job that was? And you had Ralph watching, and crowds of Sunday people around ready to start hauling apples and filling jugs and oak barrels and waiting to stick their face in the honey-colored syrupy cider shooting out of the brass spout. You had a whole bunch of neighborhood spectators come up to see that old thing work for the first time in a generation. You had a cloud of mixed bees, honeybees and bumblebees and yellow jackets waiting for that juice to come on out. You had restaurants and local food stores waiting for the best cider ever. You had the poet laureate of Guildford standing there with her pen and legal pad. You had an orange and black squeaky plastic 1950s Mickey Mouse tied with baling twine to the vertical beam waiting to start shaking. But nothing, I mean nothing could happen till the guy or the gal on the tractor seat got the rig so maneuvered that the big high wheel and all the other gears hooked up to it, started turning around and plunging up and down. When the belt and the wheels commenced flapping and turning in their slow rhythm, we all swung into action. The grinder turned unceasing and we poured in apples and more apples, mostly from abandoned orchards in a wide 15-mile radius. We'd gather them with a truck. We'd fill old grain sacks with them. They had famous names like Northern Spy and Baldwin and McCoon and Rome Beauty, Gravenstein, Wolf River, but most were mongrels you might never learn the name of. And yes, in went twigs and leaves and apple worms and yellow jackets too. And it all came out like molten, golden, sparkling, flaming, chunky apple lava into one, and then the next, and the next, and the next, framed up square of heavy cotton, the heaviest we could find. Those frames piled up atop each other till they were seven apple stories high, and then we figured how to close the valve on the one huge piston. The press went from the smooth, slow flapping of the long belt and wheel to the powerful thrusting, pumping of the piston, pushing upward, rising to flatten the tower of crushed apples against the steel plate high above. But first time it pushed up to its upper limit, pumping hard against that steel, the cider ripped right through the press cloths, spraying everywhere, and the O-ring failed on that one piston. The hydraulic fluid escaped out 100 cracks in the old leather. The piston dropped off a sudden back into its cylinder with a whoosh. The crowd groaned with one voice. The poem sat half written on the yellow paper. The key in the tractor ignition turned two notches counterclockwise to the off position. The belt slid off with no inertial motion holding it. Mickey Mouse stopped shaking. The whole hill turned real quiet. The sun moved a little bit through the autumn leaves all around us, and that was all the cider we made that day. A couple of gallons had made it to the drain, to the spout, to the jugs, and it was good. But events like that, son, they're an opportunity, huh? We found a cider press dealer still operating in a little town of Western Massachusetts. We invested in actual proven material, cider press cloths. And that store actually stocked real replacement leather O-rings for the 1925 Mount Gilead press. The men we talked to in that store gave us 100 tips we would try to remember in the weeks to come. Older men, yes, maybe they had sold their farms and orchards and had stood wet-eyed and anonymous in the crowd at auction day. But at least they held on to something you can't sell off. And they were proud to share that with us when we asked them to. I think that's the reason I never called myself a hippie. Never called our place a hippie farm, because you use a word like that, and it's like a label. You read the fine print on that label, and it says carefree, lazy, long-haired, unwashed, drug-taking, irresponsible. You know, there are always people in our society who use labels like that, and they use them to talk about folks they look down on account of their habits or their poverty, or how they were born, or the color of their skin. I like to think that when we left those folks in the orchard equipment place and headed out to the parking lot with our new press cloths and piston packing and a wealth of new knowledge, I like to think they admired our industry. We felt proud to move in where we did and take up the old ways of the old farm families. Their old farms, their old machines, their old orchard. That week, knowing how we'd get that press to work, we gathered a lot more apples. Some of the orchards we worked in were so overgrown, you could almost not tell it was an orchard. So much of the old life here was gone or almost gone, buried in new growth. It was a life we respected and wanted to know about. Cellar holes, deader graveyards, stone walls, wrecked equipment, tumble-down barns, sawmills, and orchards, too. We made up a brief new generation, just as the old land-based one was vanishing out of sight. And there was one or two last abundant seasons only left in all those things. In the Mount Gilead Press, which we gave a two-year last heyday to, after it had been silent for a generation. In the ridiculous grain combine we used only once to thresh the local wheat we grew one summer, one and only product of the now mythical Amber Waves grain growing cooperative, whose entire harvest on an unbelievably difficult, hot, sweaty, straw, sticky, deer fly plague day in August all came down to a free public meal of muffins and bread at the now defunct worker-owned Common Ground restaurant in downtown Brattleboro. And the sugar pan we salvaged and used once, we were so stupid, Dan. Used once before it melted down. The fire in our arch was hellfire hot, and the hoses bringing maple sap down from the road sprung leaks on the coupling, so the flow of sap didn't keep up with the fire, threatening the integrity of the pan. And then the next spring, when we would have made plans to use the sugar house again with maybe a smaller arch and a smaller pan, the beaver moved in and flooded the whole low-lying place out. It is still flooded to this day, with a fine house near it. The flood has become a beautiful pond where Richard and Todd live. Fed now by newly developed springs, graced by a sculpture of naked Neptune. But who remembers the sugar house that was there? I must be the only one still thinking, remembering, writing this down to keep all this alive. What we did, son, I think I understand it now, was we got here just in time. Those old farm families, some of them were broken. It wasn't their fault. Life was so hard that their children went away to find something they thought might be better. Some had no indoor plumbing. They'd only had electricity for a few years. Some of their young men died or went bad in Vietnam. What we did, we got here just in time. There was a year or two left in every old man or woman. Like Veranda says, when Rosie sold us the farm, she already had an apartment in Greenfield. Her car was running in the dooryard, waiting for her to jump in and leave and never come back. Ever. And the machines we could see strewn around, some of them were wrecked beyond repair. Some of them became our projects, but they had all once been part of the slow turning year on the farm. With every single one we discovered that had a chance of working, we asked somebody like Ralph how to get it going. We cleaned it up, rebuilt it, bought new parts, devised the power to set it thumping, swishing, cutting. We gave it a last hurrah. The cider press, the combine harvester, the corncob sheller, the butter churn, the smoke belching home comfort wood cookstove, the hand cranked flour grinder, the two-man saw, the post hole digger, the human powered moldboard plow, the cast iron long-toothed hay tedder, the heavy iron ancient dump truck, the PTO-powered cordwood saw, so dangerous. And that's another important thing, son. Any one of those old tools could have killed us or lopped off one of our limbs in a split second, or what almost happened to me when I stupidly bent down under the upraised dump truck body to see why a thin fountain of pitch black hydraulic grease fluid was shooting out of the little pipe, and Fenwick, the woodsman, shrieked, "Doc!" as 3 tons of sheet steel and 2 tons of cordwood shot down towards me out of the sky in a split second, and I prone my body to the ground. Any one of those machines could have changed our lives forever for the worse. But instead, they got us a job of work done and gave us a real clear picture of just what technologies and practices the old back-to-the-land farmers were letting go of. We were willing to step into these Vermont History Museum dioramas before they totally froze into statues for the ages. We were willing to get dirty and nicked up just to see how all those tools worked. We were willing to lower ourselves way down on the USA food chain and hierarchy to watch, listen, learn, and understand. For a little while anyway, till we knew in our bones how difficult it all was. So no, not hippies. Don't call us that. I'm gonna jump ahead towards the end because we did fix the whole machine. Do you remember what I talked about, Ralph and the crowd and the sunny weather and the bees? Well, they were all back again the next weekend with frost in the air. The second time, that was the charm. Tractor started putt-putting. You know how some days everything just seems to line up? You ever had days like that? I want to point out that now everything that comes after this is one sentence. I'm really proud of that sentence. You have times like that if you're lucky, and even better when there's an audience, and way better when everyone in the audience suddenly wants to get more involved. They see a place to pitch in. That day they put down their old cameras and found some sticky holy work gloves to put on, double-tied their shoelaces so they wouldn't come up a casualty with all those moving parts, and soon everyone was hauling apples and brushing away twigs and handing buckets up to the hopper woman or hopper man and throwing empty sacks back down and neatening the layers of crushed apple-filled heavy cotton with a jumbo wooden spatula, and down below opening glass jugs and rinsing funnels and shaking out filter cloths and packing the full jugs in their cartons, even filling a 50-gallon oak Kentucky bourbon barrel. And yes, everyone was tasting, drinking, toasting, passing the cups and glasses around, because each time the rebuilt piston with its brand new gasket slammed for all it was worth up into the racks of apple mash, up against the steel beam, shaking everything and everyone, shaking the ground all around, 20 gallons or more of the sweetest, darkest, goldenest, September light sparkling, freshest apple cider anyone anywhere had ever tasted came shooting horizontal out of the spout with the force of a fire hose. And the day imprinted on everyone's calendar, 6 months after maple syrup time, the beginning of the old farm year, here we are at the tail end. The leaves that were just about to bud out in sugar time, they're yellowed now and dead. And a whole growing season has come and gone. Now it's harvest apples, and the antique press built for the job is alive again, and the heart turning toward winter. I, for one, will never forget the sound, the light, the color, the taste, the smell. A memory like this is so powerful in the mind and the body that it overflows, and you need a place to store it. I keep mine in this wreck of a truck chassis over there. I hope they never drag it away.
This is
acapella. It's funny because I should introduce Dan a little bit more to you. Maybe some of you don't know, he's a timber frame artist of you know, the highest quality, but in which makes, you know, builds big stuff like this. But when he's not building timber frames, he's building the beautiful guitars that he makes. He's built about 20 of them. I keep waiting for him to pick it up and play it, you know, but now he's going to do another acapella song.
That story was about, partially at least, about the Mount Gilead Press, and the little company in Western Massachusetts still has available leathers for that same Mount Gilead Press. If you want one, you could go there today. Maybe the same people, maybe different, but they still will tell you how to put it in and how to keep it intact, etc. This is a song that my mom used to sing. It was collected in New Hampshire about this time that Mount Gilead Press was built, actually. And Peter has another story in the collection about making apple pies, which he did professionally, essentially did it for his living. And you'll see when you read it the trials and tribulations of that. This song is from a century earlier, from the 19th century. The apple pies that they made in the 19th century, since they had no way to preserve the apples, they dried the apples in the fall. And then when they wanted to make a pie later on, they took those dried apples out and made a pie out of them. So no relationship to Peter's pies that you're, or to this fresh cider that was coming out of those. But sing along on the chorus to this here. It's about dried apple pies. I like good bread, I like good meat, and any food that's fit to eat. But of all the grub beneath the skies, the poorest is dried apple pies. I loathe, abhor, detest, despise, abominate, dried apple pies. The farmer takes his gnarliest fruit. It's bitter, hard, and tough to boot. He leaves the cuff to make you cough, and don't take half the peelings off. I loathe, abhor, detest, despise, abominate, dried apple pies. Then from some dirty cord they're strung, and in some chamber window hung, and there they're left to roost for flies until they're ready to make pies. I loathe, abhor, detest, despise abominate dry apple pies. So tread on my corns and tell me lies, but don't feed me dry apple pies.
So at the end of cider season, there were still a couple more seasonal jobs that we had to do. We had to slaughter. We slaughtered a pig or two, and we slaughtered some beef. There's some stories in there about that too. And then in the wintertime, at least you could have some respite if you gathered enough wood. You could stay warm. And there's something in there about that too. But one of our favorite things to do in the wintertime was to clear away the dishes from supper. And some people went off to their rooms and stuff to do their own thing. But there were about three or four of us who loved to play music. And people came from other households around to play. And this is one of the songs we loved to play. You should keep your minds fresh. Because this is the kind of a song where you might be able to quickly write a verse of your own. And if you have one, you chew it around in your brain and you want to say, ooh, I got one. Then you're more than welcome to. Where is now my father's family? They were here so long ago, seated by the old home fireside, heated by the ruddy glow. There's a chorus. And we will all be reunited in that land beyond the skies, where there'll be no separation, no more parting, no more sighs. Some have gone to lands far distant, for with us they could not stay. They have gone away forever, gone away so far away. And we will all, can't hear you, be reunited in that land beyond the skies, where there'll be no separation, no more parting, no more sighs. Anybody have a verse yet? We sang this, it was Willie, my son, and I sang this at the funeral for Marty Jaser. We made up a verse. Where's now my old friend Marty, with his smile so big and wide? I can see him organizing all them angels on the other side. Last time, and we will all be reunited in that land beyond the skies, where there'll be no separation. So as you know, I still work actually. I started working with Stephen Stearns in 1978, and we still do stuff together. I mostly direct at the theater that he founded. But we've done about 3,500 shows together all around the world. And I remember once we were at the Tavern Restaurant, and we're meeting with Larry Lawler because he was going to do some technical work for a show that we were about to tour, and the waitress eavesdropped on our conversation, and that was a bit brazen, but of course not very brazen because this is Vermont, this is Brattleboro, and we're all related that way. And she leaned over and she said, "You know, I'm a performer too. I'm a storyteller," and that's when I first met Cynthia. And I thought she was lovely, and we, in the early days of her living around here and performing around here, we did some shows in which we were both on the same stage, not quite at the same time. But I always think of her as a wonderful storyteller. I haven't been so close to her during her years as a school teacher, so it's really as a storyteller that I know her best of all. She's a fantastic storyteller, and so when I heard about what happened to her, I sent her a copy of the book because I figured that she'd have some downtime and people might want to read to her. I also told her that someday she could be a storyteller again because she'll have a lot to tell. So it's just a thought. Just a thought. Would you like to hear another story?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And then we'll sing another song. There's a lot of them here. They're all my favorites. But the people up in Montpelier a couple nights ago liked this one. This is called "I Want to See the Pictures." I'm sitting in Mocha Joe's basement cafe on Main Street, Brattleboro, Vermont, my town. I just this moment realized that I'm sitting near where Shoshana used to take a break inside the Good Life. She'd grab a smoke, or she'd repack some of the grains or dried fruits for the health food store above, or just relax for a moment, calm her breathing, and ask herself how she knew that the crew-cut man pretending to check out the fancy jam apricot conserve was FBI, and that he'd come to check out her. "Come again," she told him, with full-on sarcasm, putting the jam in a Good Life bag, because she knew he would. Shoshana was on the lam, gone underground. Her name was actually Patricia Swinton. She'd fled New York City when things had gone terribly wrong with the left-wing study group she belonged to. Their anti-war politics they met each week to talk about had turned into action plans and bomb-building diagrams, maps, and lists of targets, buildings, or parts of buildings, anyway, blew up. No one was hurt, but major global banks and corporations were wounded, and they struck back. What did she actually do? What was her part in the process? I don't know. They say the dinner on the table at Swinton's apartment was still warm when the cops broke down the door, but she was gone. How she ended up at Packer Corners Farm is a whole other story. I would love for her to tell it, but she's moved on to other things. "No one wants to hear about this, Peter," she says. "It was such a long time ago." People arrived at the farm, maybe one new person every couple of years. You heard about them, then they were nearby, then they visited, you got used to them, and then they lived there. Often enough, that took the place of someone who had moved away. Shoshana, as we knew her, lived with us at Packer Corners Farm for 5 or 6 years in the 70s. We knew who she was. We harbored a fugitive, a dangerous criminal. When she was finally arrested, we were so surprised. "To think you can live with someone," we said to the reporters, "and not know who she really is." We put up our whole farm for bail. Risk of flight? We talked about it. If she had flown, we would have lost everything. Everything. Our home, our barn, and fields and garden. Our special soil, our community, all the work we'd put in. But what was a communal farm worth if you couldn't wager all of it on the character of one of your own? Our life on that land was based upon more sharing than any of us had ever experienced. What is any life worth if you can't bet it all when you must? At the meetings, the decision to go bail was unanimous, and Shoshana came home to us from Rikers Island. It was a heady time at the farm, the year of the Shoshana Defense Group. Some of the most exciting radical feminists in the whole USA arrived at our door. Scary. T. Grace Atkinson, Andrea Dworkin, Grace Paley, Marge Piercy, Sister Mary Alice Scully, some others like Angela Davis and Asada Shakur, whom we knew had battles of their own to fight. Some of the best conversation ever heard in our kitchen, which we called the Café Depresso. The Café Depresso. And some of our best conversation ever heard there happened during those visits. I lay low. You bet I did. I keep a low profile, I told myself. Wash dishes, carry out the compost, take care of the kid, be watchful, bake pies. I may have occasionally questioned the long-standing, monogamous, heterosexual relationship I was in with Ellen, but I never had deeply explored the question nor turned from the relationship, and I don't think she had either. Now I hope that our binary structure would stand up to the scrutiny it suddenly received. Quietly, I watched for signs that some of our more militant visitors looked upon our relationship as a lower evolutionary form of a male-dominated nesting behavior. But our union, such as it was, survived a while longer. And what's more, most of the city women gladly put on boots, overalls, and work gloves and volunteered for stints of rural re-education. Later, we all met up again as friends and comrades, the courtroom filled with a farm delegation, the support group folk, former red diaper babies all, maybe many New York City friends, and the straight and alternative media. When we first entered Lower Manhattan's big, scary federal court building, it felt as though our Shoshana would be set up for years, for decades. It was clear that Judge Kaufman hated the defendant. He was surprised that she was fighting the charges, that she didn't leap to his offer of a plea deal and a 10-year sentence. Other former bombers and fellow travelers had gone for the lighter sentence. "I'll put you away for 30 years," he told her quietly. But it also became clear that there was not a lot of actual proof, you know, no evidence linking her to any actual bombing. The group's leader, Sam Melville, had been executed in the Attica uprising. And the two of Shoshana's co-conspirators, who had pled guilty, refused to testify against her. The FBI agent who'd gained the trust of the group looked embarrassed and disheveled and not credible on the witness stand. In my memory, none of that mattered quite as much as Shoshana's lawyer's claim that some of the folks either in or around the group were undercover agents, one working for the FBI, one working for the NYPD, and another working for anyone who would pay him. And it was the first time I ever heard anyone use the expression agent provocateur in a live sentence. The jury smiled, Judge Kaufman scowled and slammed out his papers, gaveled us all away, and we took the elevator down and out into the sunlight of freedom. Shoshana walked. The farm was signed back over to us, and we went home. There are no photos of the courtroom drama. If you read the article in the Daily News archives, you'll find some adequate sketches of the main actors, quick line drawings suggesting the out-of-control hairiness of the times. I wish there were some photos. Photos. That reminds me, before the trial, while the tension was still mounting, some of our household had gone to New York to get ready. I was sitting and reading in the depressa with the skeleton crew. My son Eli was with me. He was 3 years old. It was one of those days when the few people left at home were starved for stimulation. Maybe living on a side hill Vermont farm wasn't such a good idea after all. Maybe there was a reason that young folks born into rural poverty often moved away. Farm work had its momentum, its pitiless inner logic and command of the clock, but boredom and frustration were a constant threat. You pulled up. You almost let yourself feel the force of it, and then you shrugged and got back to work. Eli played with his matchbox farm equipment on the dirty wooden floor, mimicking what we'd be doing when the fields dried out in a month or two. I wish I had scooped up some of what lay on the wide cracks between the boards of that floor, bagged up a sample, and put it away. The 1970s commune movement archaeology lab would love it. I'll save them the labor. Analysis of the dried matter would have revealed breadcrumbs, mold spore, mouse droppings, desiccated flypaper goo, insect parts, marijuana stem and seed sweepings, hay dust, driveway grit, wood ash, maple splinters, lead paint, pig shit, dried up homebrewed wine and beer, old apple peelings, and tears. That's what Eli was picking up with his front end loader. Vroom, vroom, vroom. And then an arriving auto caught my eye. A city car. Not full of feminists. No unexpected guest you'd be happy to see with her arms full of city treats and the latest news from those places we'd left behind. The dark car stopped at the crossroad that gave our farm its name. The little north window gave me a nice view of them. It's the cops, I said to anyone who'd listen. The feds. We'd heard that the FBI was still skulking around the town. We don't have to let them in. Nope. Let's meet them in the driveway. Okay. I picked up Eli, balanced his legs around my right hip for moral support. I was carrying him, but he was holding me up. Just as I've said in other places in this book, if you didn't live through 1968, you have no idea how it felt. You carried around a ready mental mix of paranoia and defiance. Part of the backwash of 68 was the official obsession with domestic terror, just as bad as the current fear of international terror. Every post office in the country had wanted posters in plain view, and the folks on the posters were like people whose books you had read, people you'd gone to college with, people whose ideas you passionately discussed at the dinner table, folks you might have gone to a barn dance with or founded a health clinic with who no longer looked anything like they looked in the photo album. Their mission of the feds was to find these people in whatever hole they were hiding, bring them to justice, punish them, lock them away, and keep our nation safe from its own radicalized children. You had to know how to handle the cops, but they weren't the only threat. Grand juries loomed over us. At any time they could impaddle one, just to force out information they were sure you had. If you refused to talk, you'd be held in contempt and sent right up to jail for 18 months. I didn't think I could survive that. And I was a stutterer. If someone tried to make me talk, who knew what would happen? Two men in hats and trench coats met me halfway to the farmhouse from the corners. One of them flashed a Federal Bureau of Investigation ID. My innocent farm morning had spilled me into a rerun of Dragnet. Traditionally, I don't talk well at a time like that, especially with figures of authority, male ones. Maybe Eli's legs around my hip gave me some power, but I spoke up. You guys have a warrant? No, the man said. I looked around for some town cop who might have been hanging back. Accompanying them. Federal investigators need a local guy to get that piece of paper to gain entry. I'd done my research. We all had, with our farm on the line. We don't have to talk to you if you don't want to. No, you don't, but and you can't come in. We don't want to come in, he said. We just want to show you some pictures. Every young person alive today should become a student of those times. It was pre-NSA, long before we had surveillance cameras at every corner. Hi. The poor old gumshoes had to lug photo albums all over the country. And where they carried them was to farms like ours. If our commune could spit out a Pat Swinton, maybe it or one of our sister farms could manifest a Patty Hearst, a Bernadine Dorn, a Danny White, a Bill Ayers, a Kathy Wilkerson, a Catherine Power, and Abby Hoffman. So they drove their city cars up the long, rutted roads. They got dirt on their tires and on their shiny shoes, all to try to get the hippies to look at their photo albums. As if any one of us would ever have said, oh, look, here's a picture of Sunshine. You mean that's not her real name? There she is. She's up fixing fence up in the upper pasture. You see her? You want me to go get her? That was never going to happen. We knew about solidarity. We live within its many layers, from our intentional non-blood family to our neighbors who sometimes needed our help, to the peasants and students and artists of South America, through the international workers of the world. It was solidarity all the way. Our farm had a fabric of cooperation that would always resist the probe of law enforcement. But Richard Nixon and J. Edgar Hoover had it all worked out. They weren't looking to score. They only wanted to make those punks, the blacks, the hippies, the anti-war creeps, the pot smokers, the free love gals with the armpit hair. They wanted to make them paranoid, make them feel like they were constantly being watched, like the man could drive into the dooryard at any time. Does this sound familiar? Clearly, I was not interested in the photos. But in an accidental glance, I saw the famous grainy black and white of Patty Hearst wielding the machine gun during that Symbionese Liberation Army bank heist. And one other photo her family must have supplied, the prim Berkeley undergrad in a white blouse and circle pin. Who else would I have seen if I had stayed and looked? People I had studied with at Brandeis or the Black Panthers who'd gotten away when Fred Hampton was murdered in his bed by the Chicago cops, or that quiet organizer working on Native American causes in far upstate New York. You know who that is. Or Joanne who'd fled the crash on the Jersey Turnpike and somehow made it all the way to Cuba. Or we don't have to look at them. No, you don't have to. It's true. But we need your help to find these people. They're criminals. I must have broken the stalemate. Have a good day, maybe I said, as I moved to turn back to the quiet of the house. But I guess I hadn't realized what a boring morning it had been up to that point. It was for this meeting that this day's sun had risen. Eli decided to throw one of his very rare tantrums. Maybe you know how that feels when your child is balanced on your hip and starts to pitch back and forth like a rodeo bull. One of our favorite things to do, you see, on an indoor day was to look at pictures. We had no television, no magazine subscriptions, but most of us had arrived with all our possessions, which included boxes of family photos. And as a famous farm, famous long ago, we had been photographed so often by news services and wandering visual artists that we had piles of pictures, not to mention Life magazine articles and big coffee table books about us. Our children loved to look at the photos and hear the adults tell again and again and again the story behind each photo. And we had complicated relationships with paparazzi. We had fled to the farms and forests, and some of us were fugitives, but our plain clothes were deliberately shabby chic, genuinely work-stained, yes, but not patched and handed out by generations of necessity. Sometimes we were naked. Still, the cameras clicked. We hated the intrusion, but we enjoyed the product. We hid in plain sight. We reveled in our pioneer beauty, our clear eyes, our long hair, our muscles, our boots, and we loved to see the graven images of the work we did, each task a novelty, a just-learned dance. The revolution was photographed. We didn't have mirrors. We didn't even have a bathroom. Instead, we had reflecting beaver ponds and pictures. I have a box of them somewhere. Stop by someday, and I'll show you. The cops didn't look at us the way we saw ourselves. Where we saw all that gentle truth and beauty, they saw criminals, drugs, free love, dirt, a many-tentacled threat to the social order. Their photos weren't art or even important social history. They were mugshots. Eli was rocking and bucking and reaching his little arms out for the albums in FBI hands. He was screaming, his voice just inches from my ear, "I want to see the pictures!" His tears flowed. "I want to see the pictures!" As the two men stood with their half-open album, wondering whether he could help them with a child's easy honesty. "I want to see the pictures!" As we turned toward the house and left the men in the driveway, his voice didn't quit. It gathered volume. "I want to see the pictures!" As we went back into our dark kitchen, he wouldn't stop. "I want to see the pictures!" As the unmarked car started up and turned around and headed back down the road. And I want to say here, I should have stopped that car. And I said, "FBI, Don't go away mad. You know, we're friends. 40 years from now, Donald Trump is going to be president, and we're going to need you, okay? So, okay. I don't want to break the relationship here, okay? Anyway, I want to see the pictures as the unmarked car drove away. I want to see the pictures. I still hear his cry in my memory each time I return to the farm. And I walk from the corners to the house, and I pass the very place in the driveway where we had met the men in overcoats. I hear it today as I sit and think and remember, and the images come back to me ever more clearly in Mocha Joe's. The cafe is full of new, young people who belong to a different time. They could look right through me and not see me if I let that happen. Some of them, when they dressed for this day, looked in their mirror and unconsciously put on a shirt or a shawl or chose an accessory of our original Back to the Land style. I want to see the pictures. Well, I want to see them too.
When I first got the idea to have Dan come in, and I was talking, and I told him the whole history, he just said, "Let's do a protest song, okay?" So it's a sort of an absurdist story written by John Prine. You all will know it. You'll have to help us sing along in the chorus. The story is as absurd as any of the stories that Peter has spoken of, and as insidious as well, you know, with Shoshana and her, all of that she went through as well. So the storyline here is you don't have to pay a lot of attention to it, but the chorus is as good now as when John Prine wrote this song, as a result of the things that Peter's stories mentioned, the Chicago Convention and the Vietnam War, and we're right back at it, and your flag decal still will not get you into heaven. You know? I was digesting Reader's Digest in the back of a used bookstore when a flag decal with gum on the back fell out on the floor. So I picked it up and I ran outside and I stuck it on my window screen. And if I could find old Betsy Ross, I'd tell her how good I feel. But your flag decal won't get you into heaven anymore. It's already overcrowded from your dirty little wars. Jesus don't like killing, no matter what the reason. And your flag decal won't get you into heaven anymore. So I went down to see my bank, and this is what they said to me. If you'll open up a new account, we'll give you 10 decals for free. So I didn't hesitate a moment, and I did just what they said. I stuck them all over my window screen and one on my wife's forehead. But your flag decal won't get you into heaven anymore. It's already overcrowded from your dirty little wars. Jesus don't like killing, no matter what the reason for. And your flag decal won't get you into heaven. Decals that I couldn't even see, and I drove my car off the side of the road, smashed into a tree. And the doctors got to me, I was already dead, so I couldn't understand why the man standing at the pearly gate said, "Your flag decal won't get you into heaven." Overcrowded from your dirty little wars. And Jesus don't like killing, no matter what the reason for. And your flag decal won't get you into heaven anymore. is a song that Dan suggested that we sing, or maybe I should. Anyway, this is a song that really tells the whole story of our farm in shorthand. Go ahead and lead it. And we've practiced this multiple times, so it will come off completely without a hitch. We're sure of that. Well, when I first came to this land, I was not a wealthy man. So I got myself a farm, and I did what I could.
Oh, that's Richard.
And I called my farm Muscle in My Arm. But the land was sweet and good, and I did what I could. When I first came to this land, I was not a wealthy man. So I found myself a wife, and we did what we could. And I called my wife Love of My Life, and I called my farm Muscle in My Arm. But the land was sweet and good, and we did what we could. When I first came to this land, I was not a wealthy man. So I got myself a cow, and I did what I could. And I called my cow No Milk Now, and I called my wife Love My Life, and I called my farm Muscle in My Arm. But the land was sweet and good, and we did what we could. When I first came to this land, I was not a wealthy man. So I got myself a hen, and we did what we could. And I named my hen Remember When, and I called my cow No Milk Now, and I called my wife Love of My Life, and I called my farm Muscle in My Arm. But the land was sweet and good, and we did what we could. When I first came to this land, I was not a wealthy man. So I got myself a truck, and I did what we could. And I called my truck Let's Get Stuck, and I called my hen Remember When, and I called my cow No Milk Now, and I called my wife Love My Life, and I called my farm Muscle in My Arm. But the land was sweet and good, and we did what we could. When I first came to this land, I was not a wealthy man. So I got myself a daughter and a son, and we did what we could. I called my daughter and my son, my work's done.
Not true, of course. That's not true. As most of you know, when you have a daughter and son, that's when the work, the real work starts. I just wanted to say, you know, a lot of people think of me as a theater guy, but I've always been a writer. I've wanted to be a writer all my life. And the first book I wrote, first complete book, was Burnt Toast. And then I've written five other books since then, which have been published, and about three or four which are not published yet. I'm working on a new one now. But at the end, after we sing another song and after we have a few questions, I'm going to auction off the collected works. Peter Gould. The bidding has to start fairly high because, as you know, the Burnt Toast, it has now worth $2,000. Okay? But we have Burnt Toast, A Peasant of El Salvador, Mick Bush, Right Naked, Marley, and if you haven't already gotten one, horse-drawn yogurt. And there, so this is actually pretty special. This is the first time that all six of these books have been together in a bag. And you get this nice book bag that says the collected works of. So it is true that I still spend a lot of time doing theater, and actually the writing of the book and the performing of the book is sort of becoming a theater piece in its own right. It's different every time. I have about seven or eight readings scheduled still to come over the next month or so. And but I do find time to write. And you all know that if you are a writer, if you call yourself a writer, then you have to write. Otherwise you're telling a lie. Sometimes when I write it, it comes out fiction. Sometimes it's poetry. Sometimes prose. Sometimes it's even a song, as you heard with the Ballad of the Dinosaur Egg. So when President Trump issued his decree about stopping all the visitors from coming from other countries to the United States. And this happened just a few nights after his inauguration, and the decree went out that certain undesirable people would not be allowed anymore into the country. And lawyers in New York City and Boston, still dressed in their best clothes, left the cocktail parties and dinner parties where they were enjoying themselves with their friends, and they ran to the airports as fast as they could to try to do something to stop people from being sequestered, from being sent back, from being tortured, from being put into rooms where they couldn't make a phone call for 8 or 10 hours. And those lawyers, you know, we all think about lawyers sometimes in a negative way, sometimes. But that was an hour. Lawyers to me were the, like, one of the highest models of human behavior, generosity. So I wrote this song, and I'm using the song to raise money for like a whole other benefit for the human rights groups that are sending lawyers and also human rights workers all over the United States to ports of entry to help people who are trying to get in, or trying to see their mothers, trying to get back to their families, trying to get back to the college where they teach, etc. And it was pretty easy to write the song, because the song had already been written. I mean, the words, I mean, I just took them from the base of the Statue of Liberty. And since the song is pretty fresh, it might come out crooked. At our sea-washed, sunlit gate, she stands. A mighty woman with a torch. Mother of exiles, mother of exiles. It's a call and response. Give me your tired,
give me your poor.
I lift my lamp beside the golden door. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. While her mild eyes command the harbor where we open to the world. Give me your tired.
Give me your poor.
I lift my lamp beside the golden door. To ancient lands, she opens wide her hands. To huddled masses yearning to breathe free. You're homeless. Refugees, give me your tired,
give me your poor.
I lift my lamp beside the golden door. The wretched refuse of your war-torn shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed, to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Give me your tired.
Give me your tired.
Give me your poor.
Give me your poor.
I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Last time. Give me your tired.
Give me your tired.
Give me your poor. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Thank you. Thanks, Dan. It's been a long evening, but before we leave, just make sure as you go out that you leave a donation in my squeeze box. I'll be over there to sign some books, and one half of the proceeds from the book sales go to Cynthia's fund, and I'll be auctioning off the collected works. I know you're all champing at the bit for that one. Does anybody have anything to say? Often at these readings, somebody has a question or a comment, an observation.
I'll say thank you.
Oh, thank you. You're welcome.
Awesome.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah.
So where exactly is the farm?
Oh, where's the farm? This is interesting. You'll see it in the book that on the last page I mentioned some of the books that we read when we were at the farm and some of the books that we wrote. And the first three or four books that we wrote at the farm, all of us either in individuals or one as a group, we made absolutely clear that if any reader tried to follow the directions in any of the writings in the books, they'd get hopelessly lost. Because it was not that kind of a farm. We just didn't want people to find us. Only a few people who were supposed to find us, who were friends of friends of friends, did. But the farm is in Guilford, and it's just about 100 yards away from the Massachusetts line. It's about as far south as you can get in Vermont and still be in Vermont. So you just you go south through Brattleboro. You take Route 5, you go to Algiers. There's a whole wonderful story about why Algiers is called Algiers. And in Algiers, you turn onto Guilford Center Road, and you drive along in that windy road, and then the first left turn is the Weatherhead Hollow Road. Weatherhead Hollow Road, you go down, and if you go down a certain distance, you'll see that apple tree. Good question. Any other questions or things that you'd like to know? If you have a lot of questions about the farm, all the questions are answered in the book. Thank you.